they're honest. Like, yeah, I haven't watched in a while, but like I grew up on you, or like it was very meaningful. And I always tell them, like, don't feel ashamed if you stop watching. Like, it's it's okay. Like, if we were there for any season of your life, that kept us going for that period of time. And when you left, someone else found us for like that period of time.
Hey, welcome to the break room.
Hello.
We have four people on the couches.
Yeah.
We have
Benson,
Philip,
Wesley,
and Taylor.
New dynamic.
With new cast dynamic.
I don't think we've ever had this combo.
No.
No.
Whoa. Not.
The last time it probably happened could have been lunch break.
Yeah.
This video is sponsored by Squarespace, the all-in-one platform to help build your brand or business online. But more on that later. I thought it'd be really cool, since it's the 20-year anniversary of Wong Fu Productions, if we kind of talked more candidly about Wong Fu on the break room. You guys were able to speak with NBC, mm-hmm. and they did a retrospective on Wong Fu, which was really, really nice. Yeah. And you had some good quotes there, which we'll talk about. Like you said, some friends of ours made videos wishing us happy birthday.
Yeah.
JK Films.
All the ones that are still making videos.
the two that like recognize what that means.
Yeah.
You went on Timothy De La Ghetto's.
Timothy Chaturangsu.
Sorry. Timothy Chaturangsu's.
So much has changed in 20 years.
His podcast and talked about Wong Fu.
Right.
So it's been 20 years, and the comment that I've seen sometimes is like, how have they still been around for 20 years if YouTube's not even 20 years old?
Mm.
And so June 8th, 2003. What is that date?
That is the date that Wong Fu Productions released its first video ever as like a proper, like publicly consumable video.
Yeah.
And so it was me and my college dorm mates who made this silly lip sync video over the course of our entire like first year of college. And we made a website that we, you know, made with like GeoCities or something, like real HTML coding. We got an FTP server and we sent out this link to all of our friends, going down our AIM buddy list.
Yeah.
And put it in our AIM profiles, words that I think some of you guys have no idea what I'm saying. And people had to download the video.
Mm-hmm.
And that was the first time that a Wong Fu Productions video went out into the world.
Yeah. So that's how it's before. It predates YouTube.
Yeah, there's no YouTube yet. We had to get our own like server space. The buddy list AIM, AOL Instant Messenger, was just like kind of like that was our social connection. There was Facebook hadn't even been existed.
Oh, right.
Not
right,
in
right,
2003. Three.
It was 2004. Yeah, and even then it was invite only.
This was actually before I met Phil.
Yeah.
So I had no part in that first video.
He makes that very clear.
No, because I think it's really interesting. I think it's very interesting.
Did you see the video before you met Phil?
Yeah.
Yeah.
I can speak about Wong Fu purely as a fan. What was the thought? Like, you made this fun music video. I saw it. It came out finals week.
Yeah.
Right? And it was such a distraction.
Is that funny? One video was a distraction. Imagine kids now they have the entire YouTube and Twitch. So many more distractions. Video was enough.
It was a distraction because I was like, man, I want to do that.
Mm. That is a misconception, right? That people thought that Wong Fu started with just like Phil, Wes, and Ted altogether. But there was this one little year right before that it was just my roommates.
This particular video wasn't like an assignment for a class or anything.
No,
were the assignments before the video?
This was because I went to school undeclared, and so I had no idea I was going to go into arts, and so we made these videos. And if you think about it, like, it's kind of just like a TikTok these days. The audio was already there. Like, I remember making the conscious decision, like, I have to use completed audio, so a music video is the easiest thing.
And it got around to like way more people outside of the college.
So at that time, high speed internet was only available to like universities. Mm-hmm. So it passed around the UCs first, and then it kind of went from there. But I do remember, so second year happened, we're like, okay, let's make some more, like, we have the same friends. And then that's when I met Wes in one of my classes towards the end of the school year, actually.
Something I want to share with you guys, too, because I think you guys might not know. So I wanted to kind of, like, explain where we're at, like, what Wong Fu is. Mm. Currently, we have a staff of, like, what, nine people?
Nine people and plus or minus some interns. Yep.
Yeah. And our revenue has changed.
It's 10
a lot.
People.
I think it's 10.
Wow. We have 10 people staffed,
which is very low.
10 full timers
for like a production company, but very large, I guess, for a YouTube channel.
No, actually, no, that's no. About,
watcher.
Yeah, that's true. Yeah, okay. We have friends that have in the 20s.
Still
yeah.
Small. But then there are YouTubers that are still like one man bands.
Yeah,
you know,
yeah, it's a wide range.
Yeah. Right. Even your friends have like referenced how you guys were the first to adapt to like merch, mm-hmm. and that was a big step in yeah. Wong Fu's evolution to kind of generate revenue and keep yeah. going. But I guess at this point we've evolved again, and we've like Benson's been a big part of this too, building us up as like a production company.
Yeah.
So one thing that keeps us going and able to kind of pay for these videos that
these money losing videos.
Yeah. Is
invest. Invest is, I think, maybe a better word.
Yes. We're investing into yeah. ourselves.
Yeah.
Is through these this commercial work.
No, literally, I met up with like this YouTube product person like a couple of days ago, and he's also very curious, like, how are you guys still going? Because we know that we're not paying you very much because, yeah, our channel is not reliant on AdSense. You know, we're not one of these channels that, like, we need to make lots of videos that get that gets lots of views. We've, throughout our entire existence, have made the conscious choice to, like, go against everything that YouTube is modeled to be to make money. Yeah.
Maybe a little naive.
Yeah, and I told him, like, hey, don't feel bad. It's not your fault. We're laying in the bed that we made, and this was our choice to keep making the type of content that we want to. And we have to adapt our business revenue streams in different ways to allow for us to continue making the content we want.
I honestly think that that's what makes Wong Fu so unique and maybe has contributed to its longevity is this kind of commitment to storytelling and this very specific craft.
Yeah.
If any other YouTuber, and I rightfully so, they would adapt to things to kind of stay to chase like a certain level of growth and to leverage themselves as individuals to get more opportunity. But it was actually important to you guys very early on to kind of foster these types of narratives and stories and
quality, not quantity. Yeah. And I think that's actually why, I mean, I didn't mention earlier, but like the pandemic was a big reason why a lot of our peers kind of had to like slim down or drop off or switch. But for us, like, we powered through the pandemic because, again, this commitment to something greater, or like we knew that, hey, we're going to get through this. The storytelling is a big part of what we're trying to do. So yeah, like I think that's how we were able to kind of push through.
Well, let's talk about the mission. The mission didn't begin on that June 8th day, 2003. You know, we've done a lot of these interviews. You guys have had plenty of talks. I'm curious, like, when did that like seed of that mission start?
We never actually like defined it.
Yeah,
it was all three of us, or
so gradual.
But I think the first time you probably felt it when you saw the reach of your first videos.
Mm-hmm.
I think I saw the power of that. But then the first time we actually went and like went on the road out of this state and like saw people and like saw the impact that this, you know, silly fun video had on them. It was like, yeah, like that speaks so much.
Seeing the fans for the first time, like, you know, in those early days, like that definitely gave us like this boost of like, oh, there's something special here. But in terms of like, oh, what we're doing for Asians and a movement that people say that we help build or help, you know, we were the catalyst of, like, I don't think there was never like a decision or moment where we're like, oh, this is what we're going to be. I think maybe that speaks to why we are what we are, is because it was so natural to us. We didn't have to like decide and like fit ourselves into this like, you know, mission statement. We were just living.
Yeah.
We're living in this area. We had Asian friends. We believed in our Asian creator friends, and we're like, hey, more people should see you. We're fans of you. And we just kept that going. And like, it was just so natural. And I think that's why we were able to do it so prolifically, because it was just what we were always doing and living and thinking about. And over time, it's like you don't realize, but like, yeah, you're kind of doing one stroke at a time. And after a while, you're like, oh my God, we've created this massive painting. And yeah, we never saw it as we were going along.
The focus was never to change things, break boundaries, but we were making things that were fun for us, relatable to ourselves. And in that sense, it was relatable to other people.
I think that's why people say, like, I've heard this a lot. They're like, you don't even know what you did.
Yeah.
And actually now that mission statement is driving me more now. It's like settling in. Whereas like, mm-hmm. I think when we were younger, we were just like, oh, like,
I feel like you've fully like taking it on.
Wong Fu has been critiqued over the years. Even when I joined, it was like a conversation in the office, like mm-hmm. reacting to certain comments. And there was an awareness that like being one of the few creators, there's a lot of expectation that we should be kind of representing the community in, mm-hmm. in appropriate ways. And yeah. that kind of led to certain decisions and how we kind of chose content and a lot of conversations of how we wanted to like move forward. Even the Fung Bros in their video, they responded to some comments that we've heard before. Mm. There's a lot about just critiquing our content.
Yeah.
And like stuff like people feel like our content might have like gotten stale at some point, or we've hit this ceiling in terms of our maturity, and or like we always cater to a certain type of jokes or mm-hmm. romantic comedies or something like that.
Yeah.
But I mean, Andrew defended us kind of saying that it like he understands that once you've established a style of content, it's very hard to evolve year to year mm-hmm. with your audience. I wanted you guys to speak on that. How do you feel about Wong Fu's evolution of content?
Well, first of all, thanks Fung Bros for even making the video. Like, it's cool that obviously no mainstream publication or press is gonna like pick this up. So it's cool that within our own community.
We had no idea that they were gonna do that.
Yeah. We've been doing this now, you know, for so long that people that started watching us when we first started, let's say back when they were in college, are now in their 40s. How are you supposed to create content for someone that started as like a college student and is now, you know, a parent, right? But then literally like I still got stopped by like high schoolers like at Bof Mofo sometimes, you know? So I'm like, wait, how is this possible that we have this such long widespread? And it's really hard to make content for like that range, right? And we have conversations. The analogy that I give is like, oh, you can be like the Rolling Stones, and it's like, hey, we were popular for an era, and we're just going to age up with our fans, and we're just going to keep being that nostalgic era and delivering the hits, delivering the feels whenever you want to go back in time. And that's it. They're not trying to make new songs to get like new teenage fans. But then there's also like Nickelodeon, where like the fans just pass through, right? And they're like, hey, we don't expect Nickelodeon to make some edgy, you know, crime drama or whatever. Like they know what they're supposed to do, and you just pass through, right? But you have like nice memories. I feel like we're a mix, because like we're definitely not just like, hey, we're just teenage content, kid content. We never were like kid content, but like we're definitely not that. And we definitely haven't forgotten like, hey, we still want to get, you know, new fans and stay relevant. So it is like kind of like this constant dialogue that we have here, for sure.
I think that's to the credit of our fan base too. Yeah, they critique us, but we have like some of the most positive and encouraging, supportive fans all around the world. And the fact that they can make us the Rolling Stones model, where they, you know, they tell us that they have kids now and families now, and they still watch us and they still remember that time, like, that's because they decided, you know, that we were important enough, or we meant something, so that they would, you know, not forget us in that way.
It's kind of like, does anyone ever go to Wes Anderson and say like, dude, man, you got stale, dude? It's like, no, people like, they want that out of that. And as long as he feels like he's still being honest with himself and proud of it, I think the people that might say that, they think that like this is unauthentic or inauthentic to us. Like, they're like, man, you guys just haven't grown up. It's like, no, like this is actually kind of like what we think is funny, or this is like our personality. And like, I might even challenge some of these people, like they're not even watching that deep into it, because like we actually have pushed ourselves in different pieces of content,
for sure.
You know, so
I think those comments are perfectly fair, and maybe their tastes have aged in a certain way,
which is fine.
Which is totally fine. I think we are still a production company, a YouTube channel that needs to fulfill certain metrics or fulfill certain like criteria to have a successful video, right?
Yeah.
And like that, like that's just the landscape of the game. It's like baseball, it's like any other organized game or sport or whatever. There are certain things that are part of the game.
And we like the game too. Like,
but the thing is, like, we can still become better players in that game, right? Even if you play by the same rules. So I think Phil, myself, Taylor, Benson, everyone here has grown as a storyteller. Like, I look at some of my past work, and even though it's like the classics or the ones that people love, I look at it and I'm like, oh, that was a long time ago, and I'm over that phase. I want to do different things now, and those are on the channel too.
Yeah.
So
I think like we get a lot of comments, and even when I see people in person now too, like they're like, oh, I haven't, they're honest. They're like, yeah, I haven't watched in a while, but like I grew up on you, or like it was very meaningful. And I always tell them, like, don't feel ashamed if you stop watching. Like it's, yeah, it's okay. Like if we were there for any season of your life, any like, you know, handful of years, like that kept us going for that period of time, and it overlaps. And like when you left, someone else found us for like that period of time. Right. And I think like that's super cool. And that, you know, we're all sharing, like my dream is that someday like Wong Fu is like an SNL, you know, where there's just different eras of it, different generations that liked different periods and say, oh, like that was the best Wong Fu. Like, he's like, that was this new Wong Fu, like, oh, this is crap, you know, like, but then there's people that are growing up on this Wong Fu that thinks that this is really great too. So, but I will say like, hey, whatever we were to you at that period of time, like in some ways we still want to be that for another person that's going through that period of their life too.
This really is us trying to consider all those variables that you're talking about, but still do it our way and on our terms.
Yeah.
We're making content that ultimately we as a team are interested in.
And we don't,
with all the things considered.
I think also what a lot of people don't realize, because you can look at the numbers, and I'll be the first, we'll be the first to like acknowledge, yeah, like YouTube numbers are not the same as they once were.
Yeah, we see them. Yeah. We see them too. Yeah, yeah.
But like what people, like if you really want to like get into like nerd out about this, is that, well, back then, the only place to watch videos online was YouTube. Mm-hmm. So anytime someone wanted to consume a piece of content, it only existed in one place in one form, which was the YouTube video. So it's all going there. And now, you know, eyeballs are spread between so many platforms, and we adapt. That's something that we adapted to, as like, you know, we had to improve our game and everything and play a little bit along. Our content spread across so many platforms. So it's like, if you're only watching us on YouTube, that's just you. Like there are a lot of people that are finding us out on other platforms that maybe you're not familiar with, which is where like a lot of our other numbers are. Mm-hmm. So it's confusing to me too. Like even for me, I'm like, wait, like I see that those numbers, but I have to remind myself, it's like, oh wait, no, the culture is different now, right? Consumption culture, creator culture is so different.
And those early years too, the mainstream hadn't even taken notice of YouTube. Like they weren't even on there.
And so now we're competing even against those eyeballs.
Talk shows and news.
Yeah.
If you were to compare Wong Fu to something that is mainstream, I think maybe the closest comparison is something like an SNL or Key & Peele or Mad TV. Yeah. But you look at these shows and like, yeah, they have a very good reputation for making good content, but 9 times out of 10, that sketch or that short that they make is forgotten. It's like
but
a
they have,
flub, right? But they have the volume. They have the team of writers. They have the budget. They have all of that. And then even their cast is like all-star cast, right? Yeah. So
they can make 10 and 9 can suck, but as long as
if the
internet's talking about one, that's fine.
Exactly.
But we're releasing one at a time.
Right.
So if we have 9 in a row that are not hits or whatever, then people are going to be like, "Oh my god, you guys suck."
Now. So it's not like we're not trying. We're trying. It's just, you know,
we don't have the backing to just put it all out at once, which is actually something we've talked about here too, which is like, "Oh, the dream would just be we go away for a few months, drop them all, come back, do it again." Like that would be really fun too. Yeah.
The sponsor of today's video is Squarespace. We love Squarespace and been using their platform to build our brand and business online for years. We've used one of their flexible website templates to create our own site. From there, we were able to customize and add features to fit our needs as a production company. One of those features is the ability to create video collections. We can take the videos from our different platforms and organize them together in one beautiful video page. Squarespace also gives us the tools we need to set up an online store for our NARA brand. Their interface makes it super simple, whether you're selling physical, digital, or service products. Head to squarespace.com for a free trial, and when you're ready to launch, go to squarespace.com/wongfu to save 10% off your first purchase of a website or domain. All right, back to the video. I think what people know Wong Fu for, and when I hear it from like TikToks, people talking about the OG YouTubers they watch, or just even Bart and what he was talking about in his...
Yeah, shout out JK for making a video too. That was unexpected.
That was unexpected.
We can talk about that, yeah.
I feel like people see Wong Fu as like the collaborators, you know, the people that bring people together.
Yeah.
And Bart even talked about how much he appreciated when Wong Fu would like invite them out, because I don't think they thought that they were included in a lot of these things.
Yeah.
And he spoke directly to Phil about like being included in Rise and like the charity games and stuff like that. Well, first off, how did you respond to that?
At a certain point, you know, there's just people that are in the community that are just undeniable. Like mm-hmm. for me, like including them in the book or including them in some of these events, it's like, yeah, it's a no-brainer. Like, sure, our audiences might not be the same, or maybe there's like a little bit of crossover or whatever, and our content's different. But it's like, hey, the same thing that we're all saying, like, Asians are not this monolithic group. We're not just one type of style of humor, one type of storytelling. So it's like, okay, there's other people in our community that clearly, you know, like them and they're changing lives in their own way. So you gotta respect the game or whatever, mm-hmm. respect what they're doing too.
Why? Because it takes so much work for you guys to do what you have did. Like yeah. with these, so many of these events, ISA concerts and yeah. stuff like that. I mean, you worked with a lot of people, but like, just like, what was the choice to like actually make that effort that a lot of people wouldn't have in the community too?
I'm trying to think back. Like,
you mean like to why did we reach just, out?
Why did we do it? Why did we?
Yeah. Why did? How, like, was there a choice to position yourselves?
This is gonna sound bad. There weren't a lot of hard choices where it was like, yeah. Phil, I think these are our options.
Yeah.
Let's like.
Yeah.
You know, it wasn't like the first thing I remember was like, hey, there's this singer, David. I like his music. We should work with him.
I think that's the thing. Like there was no, we didn't have like this choice process. Like, what should we do? Yeah. Like, there were so few opportunities that we just had to just
create it for yourself.
Take what was already kind of there or create it for ourselves.
And it wasn't like a strategy thing either, where we were like, okay, these are the main players. We got to make sure we collab with each of them. Mm-hmm. It wasn't like that. It's in the nature of us not wanting to be in front of the camera. Like, we were like, okay, who else can we plug into these things that we're making? And that was a way for us to like,
yeah, that start, makes a lot of sense.
Start that infrastructure.
Yeah. I think like with the early ISA concerts for us, it was also like, we knew how big some of these people are. And, and maybe the little bit of selfishness was like, hey, we believe we're pretty big, but no one believes it. Mm-hmm. And so the only way to like, get people to like believe it is if we just kind of come together,
align ourselves,
right? And if no one's gonna do it, then I guess it's got to be us.
We keep talking about like the golden age of YouTube or the Asian American scene on YouTube or whatever you want to call it. I think everyone in that time recognized it. I think we were the ones that said, let's do something together.
Yeah,
I think everyone saw it, was like excited for each other. Oh, you're doing that thing, and then we were like, hey, we're the ones that can actually bring them together.
I remember there was a period of time where we took a bunch of non-actors and turned them into actors. Like, we took dancers, we took singers, you know, we took makeup gurus, and we made them actors.
Plug them in.
Yeah. And I think that, like, that's what really made people start seeing, like, oh, Wong Fu is this big connector. Because we were this sandbox that talent could come in and play with our tools and in our ecosystem.
And eventually that became a little bit of a credit for everyone. Oh, I was on a Wong Fu thing.
Yeah.
And then, oh, you're on a Wong Fu
thing? They were even saying that Victor Kim, like, was, like, really proud and, like, had this new confidence from working with you guys.
I mean, if talking about what happened, like, Jen from Head to Toe literally moved out here, right? Like, that was, like, a big part of her move. And there's a bunch of those stories. And I think, like, it was also just fun to work with people we liked and respected. And we knew that there was, like, a lot of excitement around, like, these people and the content that everyone was making. So to kind of just feel like we were at that forefront was, you know, was definitely exciting for us too.
I guess one last question. Just where do you predict Wong Fu to be in the next 20 years? June 8th, 2043.
How old will your son be?
He will be 22.
Oh my God.
21, yeah.
He'll be drinking.
You know what's crazy is that, like, that's not that... Like, I can see that. Like, and like, 2043 sounds like so far, but also like a 21-year-old growing up, like, oh yeah, that seems normal. That's so normal. So we're gonna get there.
Yeah.
In 20 years, we're all gonna have endeavors that are beyond what we're talking about now. Yeah. It'll be stuff outside of this platform. I mean, I've even heard hints of it. Like, you wanna have like your own studio, your own studio space. It's like, I know when you set your mind to something, it's like, it's there. And it's not if, it's like just when. Mm-hmm. So
Taylor's going to be a stand-up comic.
Yeah, and a music producer.
Yeah. Oh, that's right.
Yeah.
It's kind of that's actually going to be his shtick.
I forgot about that.
He's going to be the first DJ that's also stand up in between his sets.
He's standing up DJing.
No, his DJ set is like live editing in Premiere. Like,
I feel like no matter what we're doing, wherever, like, I feel like Wong Fu is still going to be part of it though. Mm-hmm. Or Wong Fu will be part of incorporated somewhere. Like, if you want to talk about Wong Fu specifically, like, let's take it outside of even the four of us. Mm-hmm. I think that's when. That could be really cool. Is that Wong Fu, like, it even already is. It's not tied to one person, right? And in 20 years, it'll be tied even less to maybe the people like on this couch, right?
Global.
Yeah. Who knows? But I think no matter what, like, I hope, yeah, the quality will still be there. The sentiments will still be there.
I've been thinking a lot about like the future and what we're supposed to be. And what I've arrived at is if we're none of those things, we can rest easy because what we did at 20 years is so big.
Yeah.
And like, this is enough. This is more than enough.
Yeah.
And that actually like calms me a lot because a lot of times we're like, oh, what do we have to be? What do we have to evolve to? Guys, we were a part of a big thing, and we touched a lot of people's lives.
Definitely.
Yeah. This question, like, we've never even been able to predict 5 years in, you know. So, and plus platforms are always changing. Ways to consume, like, are always changing. Like, look, 10 years ago, like, Netflix was just releasing House of Cards for the first time, and it was still sending out DVDs. We're gonna adapt no matter what. Our business will adapt. Our content will also adapt to the new platforms and technologies. So I'm excited. Like, no matter what, like, you know, I hope that it's still us involved, you know, and we're still hanging out and having fun and making weird sketches and fun ideas.
Yeah.
You know, I don't think that much is going to change, actually. Like, when I look at the first, you know, 20 years ago to now, I'm like, sure, a lot of like the scale has changed, but like the essence and the spirit is the same. And I think that's all that really matters.
That's good. Yeah. I want to hold on to that.
Right.
And hopefully you guys are with us.
So happy birthday to y'all too.
Yeah.
For this journey that you've been on with Wong Fu for 20 years or whatever point you came in. Happy birthday.
Thanks for watching all of this too.
That thing you used to say at the end of your first video, what was that thing that you wrote?
Thanks for watching.
It's the end of
thanks for watching. Thanks for watching.
And it still stands.
Thanks for watching. That's it.
Thanks for watching. It still stands.
3, 2, 1.
Thanks for watching.
Sure. All right. Mm. Bye. Bye.